Rome's dubious assessment of the adopted son of the divine Julius Caesar began to take shape at the First Battle of Philippi, which took place on October 3 of the 42 BCE. Having been carried to camp on a litter, Caesar Divi Filius then fled the battlefield as his military camp was overrun by the armies of the liberators. While 16,000 of his men were cut down by the forces of Marcus Junius Brutus, he cowered in the nearby marshes. And even though the young Caesar acquitted himself well during the Second Battle of Philippi, which took place on the 23rd of October, his victory against the assassins of Julius Caesar could not completely blot out the stigma of his cowardice. Then, 6 years later, shades of his past surfaced again at the naval battle of Naulochus. After ordering his ships to anchor, thus immobilizing them and making them easy targets, the son of the divine Julius Caesar jumped overboard and swam to shore as his vessels endured crippling attacks by the forces of Sextus Pompeius. Likely because Caesar Divi Filius was dogged by whispers that the Roman populace viewed him as gutless following these battles, Caesar became more proactive in personally settling the unrest which neglect had allowed to crop up and run roughshod over the province of Illyricum over almost 2 decades. The first hints of rebellion within Illyricum had begun in the 58 BCE, when then proconsul Gaius Julius Caesar withdrew the majority of the province's troops for assemblage of a large enough army to subjugate Gaul. Leaving little more than a handful of Roman garrisons lining the coast allowed Illyricum to devolve into a battleground overrun by the Iapetes, Pannonians, and Dalmatians, with most of the ports along the Adriatic Sea captured by pirates. Following his Gallic conquest, Julius Caesar had intended to return to Illyricum and to restore order within the province, but Rome had plunged into civil war, forcing the general down an altogether different path. From the Rubicon River, Caesar travelled to southern Italy, then to Hispania, then to Greece. From Greece and victory at the Battle of Pharsalus, Caesar was then drawn to Egypt, to Anatolia, back to Rome, then to Africa. And finally, once again, the dictator found himself in Hispania, where the last of the Pompeian armies were defeated at Munda. With the civil war finally at its end, Julius Caesar, having been named dictator for life, had plans to invade Dacia and bring stability back to the province of Illyricum before moving on to the massive undertaking that was his campaign to subjugate Parthia. Yet, none of it ever came to pass. Caesar was assassinated just 3 days before he was to leave Rome. By the end of 36 BC, both Illyricum and Parthia had joined the roster of Rome's unfinished business. And although Caesar Divi Filius had successfully defeated Sextus Pompeius, ending the boat king's blockade of Italy, it was not enough. His popularity saw a slight increase with the subsequent lifting of the famine, but the Roman people were not ready to forget who authored its inception. It had been Caesar Divi Filius who had taxed Rome's farmers an unprecedented 50% on their annual yield before the battles of Philippi, only to follow with the outright confiscation of their farmlands after his victory at Philippi, transferring ownership to his legions as military compensation, although his legions knew nothing of farming. As crops failed and Sextus Pompeius held Italy hostage with his naval grain blockade, Caesar Divi Filius negotiated peace with the last son of Pompeius Magnus by marrying the boat king's aunt, Scribonia Libo. However, as soon as grain began to flow freely into Italy, Caesar changed his mind. He divorced Scribonia abruptly to marry Livia Drusilla, antagonizing Sextus Pompeius into reinstating his blockade. So outraged were the starving people that in 37 BC, Caesar Divi Filius was attacked by a large crowd who meant to kill him, saved only by the intervention of his fellow triumvir and brother-in-law, Marcus Antonius, who had journeyed with his wife, Octavia, to Tarentum to negotiate an arms trade with Caesar Divi Filius. And always there were the cries of Caesar's lack of courage. In order to win the respect of the Roman people, Caesar Divi Filius would need to prove he was more than a clever politician who understood how to play the game of civil war. The son of Julius Caesar would have to demonstrate that he too was a conqueror, cut from the same cloth as his father. Until then, the people of Rome would see him as second to Marcus Antonius, who was already marching his forces into Parthia by the summer of 36 BC, poised to complete Julius Caesar's unfinished business. For Caesar Divi Filius, that left only Illyricum. Marching into the province, Caesar led his forces into Illyricum's interior, taking on the Secistani tribes, while Marcus Vipsanius Agrippa moved against the pirates who had taken control of the ports. With the ports finally cleared and fresh supplies able to reach the province, Agrippa joins Caesar at the siege of Segesta. There, both fell from atop a collapsed bridge, where Caesar sustained injuries to his shoulder and his leg. Following their success against the Iapetes, Segestani and Pannonians, the victorious Caesar then marched his legions to Gaul, where he planned to cross into Britannia and enforce the treaties negotiated by Julius Caesar, which had been allowed to lapse. But Caesar Divi Filius did not make it to Britannia. After leaving the province of Illyricum, the Dalmatians attacked under a leader named Versus in an attempt to reclaim lands they alleged had been stolen by the Segestani. Both Caesar and Agrippa were drawn back to Illyricum and forced to continue the fight. We know little of the events which took place in Illyricum, but while engaged in battle outside the town of Setovia, Caesar Divi Filius was injured once again when a rock launched from a sling slammed into his knee, likely breaking his kneecap. Though history is short on the details of this battle, we are told that Caesar's pain was so great that he could not even be moved on a stretcher or a wagon, and had no choice but to stay put for several weeks as his armies fought the Dalmatians. Some months later, Caesar, who undoubtedly required crutches or a walking stick, hobbled back to Rome alongside Marcus Agrippa, where both were hailed as victorious over the Dalmatians. For a second time, Marcus Agrippa was awarded a triumph by the Roman Senate, and for the second time, and for reasons we do not know, Agrippa chose not to celebrate. With most of the details of Caesar's Illyricum campaigns of 35 to 33 BC either lost or intentionally redacted from Rome's annals, it is impossible to understand what exactly took place, shrouding in mystery why it took nearly 3 years to pacify so small a region. What we do know from the historians is that after negotiating more than 30 peace treaties with individual tribes, Caesar Divi Filius and Marcus Vipsanius Agrippa were lauded as conquerors by the Roman people, with Caesar's scars and injuries now a visual defense against any rumors of his cowardice. Although the public image of Caesar Divi Filius was eventually recast from that of an inexperienced and often frightened young man to one of a militarily capable Roman general of some maturity, it was in Rome's political arena that the son of Caesar reigned supreme. With the aid of Marcus Vipsanius Agrippa, a modern general with the strategic brilliance to plan multi-strike attacks against his enemies, placing him on a par with Julius Caesar, and with Gaius Silius Maecenas as his mouthpiece, a golden-tongued orator whose ability to sway the people placed him on the level of Cicero, Caesar Divi Filius had all the tools of his trade at his fingertips. Add to that Marcus Antonius' ill-fated conquest of Parthia as a backdrop, and the timing couldn't have been more perfect for Caesar Divi Filius. In fact, Antonius hadn't even gotten to act one of his starring role, never even arriving in Parthia. He had trusted in the duplicitous King Artavasdes II of Armenia, and had marched against Artavasdes I of Media Trapetine, convinced that by defeating Media, Parthia would quickly fall. But Antonius had failed to take Media Atropatene's capital city of Phraeata, and was forced to return to Syria through Armenia's harsh winter snows, while the blackened toes of his men dropped off from frostbite. But even before Marcus Antonius had set out for Parthia, Caesar Divi Filius had begun laying the groundwork for a political ideology which would see Antonius diminished in the eyes of the Roman populace, and which would ultimately become the defining characteristic of the new Caesar's life's work, a return to traditionalism through Roman nationalism. In the space of approximately one century, the Roman Republic, which had stood for 400 years, had come tumbling down. Under the brothers Gracchi, the office of tribune of the plebs had been weaponized against the Senate's oligarchy, giving rise at length to military men like Gaius Marius, who privatized the legions via legislation that made enlistment in Rome's military a career opportunity for the lowest of Roman citizens, the head count. Marius chose to ignore well-founded arguments against his legislation that cautioned of the danger of creating professional armies beholden not to Rome, but to generals like himself, who then used the support of his privatized army to destroy Rome's mos maiorum and Roman politics, writ large, for an unprecedented 7 terms. Before long, every general had his own army, enabling him to exercise power outside the traditional channels, and finally dragging Rome down a dark and lawless path. She would endure her first civil war between the Marians and the Sullans, resulting in the dictatorship of Lucius Cornelius Sulla and his ruthless proscriptions, and then see the rise of Pompeius Magnus and Julius Caesar, which thrust Rome into her second civil war between the Caesarians and the Pompeians. And though many of the governmental changes which had taken place, achieving a more just balance of power between the oligarchy and the people, were much needed, even now, Caesar Divi Filius and Marcus Antonius, still in control of the legions, personified the shift toward tyranny, as the Roman populace held its collective breath, panic-stricken over the specter of a third civil war on the horizon. Caesar Divi Filius decided enough was enough. There had to be an end to the fighting. The Roman Empire could not survive civil war after civil war. And so the son of the divine Julius Caesar began a quiet campaign meant to communicate to the Roman people that the Eternal City was moving back in the direction of old-fashioned virtues. The office of aedile, which was normally a lower-level magistracy for men hoping to reach the consulship, was responsible for more than just entertaining the Roman people with games. Aediles were also responsible for the upkeep and repair of Rome's buildings and structures. Breaking with tradition, Marcus Agrippa, who had already held the office of consul for the 37 BC year, bowed to his love for Rome to run for and win election as aedile, whereupon he undertook a monumental overhaul of the city's most important facilities. As Caesar Divi Filius continued the reconstruction of the Forum Romanum begun by his father, Agrippa addressed the city's infrastructure. He both repaired and extended the Aqua Marcia, one of the aqueducts that carried fresh water from the Italian countryside into the city proper. Agrippa ordered and oversaw the creation of new fountains throughout the city, supplying all with fresh running water, and he built several new bathhouses which were made available, free of charge, to Rome's poorest citizens on specified days. In addition to these public works, which greatly improved the overall sanitation of the city, Agrippa also flushed out the Cloaca Maxima, Rome's sewer system, and enlarged it so that Rome's wastewater could more easily be expelled from the city, further reducing the ever-present threat of disease. As the people of Rome began to enjoy the amenities provided by Marcus Agrippa, they would also have noticed new and unusual statues decorating the city. To pay tribute to the sacrosanctity awarded to his wife, Livia Drusilla, and to his sister, Octavia Furina, recognizing them as honorary Vestal Virgins, Caesar Divi Filius commissioned statues to be erected throughout the empire. Prior to this, only Cornelia, mother of the Gracchi, had been so honored in Rome, and even her statue was commissioned only after her death. The statues of Livia and Octavia, given their female gender, broke with the Roman tradition espoused by Caesar Divi Filius, but were instrumental in his effort to return Rome to tradition, as they displayed both women in the traditional Roman stola rather than in trendy Greek clothing, and adorned with the old-fashioned hairstyle known as the nodus knot. Caesar also sought to set an example, letting it be known that he wore only clothing that had been personally woven for him by his wife, and enjoyed food prepared by her hands, painting Livia, along with Octavia, as dutiful matrons who were content to spin and weave, oversee the household, and rear their children, all in stark contrast to women who attempted to dominate the world of men, women such as Fulvia Flacca Bambula and Cleopatra. The only hitch in Caesar's plan, to his frustration, was his sister Octavia. Even as Rome idolized her statues, regarding her care of children as akin to that of Cornelia, mother of the Gracchi, Octavia had not yet returned to Rome. Even after her husband, Marcus Antonius, had spurned her, first taking from her the supplies and 2,000 hand-picked legions she had brought him, then refusing to allow her to come to him in the east, Octavia had chosen to remain in her husband's mansion in Athens. Situated between Italy and Syria, Octavia's physical location represented her symbolic position, trapped between husband and brother. Having married Antonius at the pressuring of the Senate, people and legions, in their desperate bid to avoid civil war, Octavia was acutely aware of her position. To go to one would signal war against the other. And so the woman who was both sister and wife to the remaining two triumvirs stayed put in Greece. Yet, even with Octavia in Athens, Caesar's movement to renew Rome's Romaness had its intended effect. As Gaius Maecenas helped to circulate tawdry and lascivious tales about Cleopatra's hold over Marcus Antonius, the Egyptian queen's foreignness became ever more distasteful to the Roman people. As they strolled by the many statues of true Roman matrons molded by Rome's ancient customs, the image of Cleopatra as the goddess Julius Caesar had lifted up in the Temple of Venus began to offend. Raunchy tales abounded, claiming that when not wearing the most seductive Greek and Asian fashions, Cleopatra simply walked about with her breasts exposed. Yet Divia's and Octavia's statues were emblematic of the wholesome and discreet Roman woman who needed no wigs or diadems to prove her worth. As the Roman people came to view men like Julius Caesar and Marcus Antonius as not only Cleopatra's sexual conquests, but as men through whom her greedy hands meant to acquire Rome, the people came to appreciate the simplicity of women who still dedicated their lives to spinning and weaving, cooking for their husbands, and raising their children, as in the days of old. At the Treaty of Brundisium, the legions have refused to fight, seeing only two Caesarian commanders vying for importance. But with Caesar's new but old ideology of what it meant to be Roman gaining ground among the people, it would not be long before the legions were willing and eager to fight a foreign enemy of Rome, even if that foreign enemy was Marcus Antonius himself.